the spiritual commandments or kalmas. I had spoken on Hosh Dardan, conscious breathing. Breathing has two aspects, incoming and outgoing, that is inhaling and exhaling. During both inhaling and exhaling, be conscious. This is Hosh Dardan. The second kalma is always choose to be happy. Each moment life presents different situations, circumstances and conditions. Certain are acceptable to human understanding while others are not. In all circumstances you choose to be happy, and to human understanding this is normal, while to a meditator it is not. In all circumstances you choose to be unhappy, and slowly this becomes your way of life. Your entire life centers on this unhappiness. In every situation, every moment, you always seek unhappiness or finding faults. There is a reason for it. You inherit this from birth. When a woman gets pregnant for the first time and she gets the news that I may be pregnant, her response to that is, "Oh no, a big dragged no." Then slowly she begins to accept it, and this becomes the way of our life. Any situation comes, someone asks you, "Can I get a date from you?" "Date with me? Oh no." Immediate response is no. This is an expression of indecisiveness. To be happy under all circumstances and situations, whether the things are happening your way or not, is your choice and right. To be happy is a conscious choice only you can make. But in all situations, you choose to be unhappy. Remember, a happy heart is the door to the beyond, or door to the inner, or door to the being. You tend to be happy or unhappy because of the other or circumstance. If someone does something to your liking, you are happy. You get a gift of your liking, you are happy. No one chooses to be happy for no reason. A happy heart is filled with gratitude towards the whole, through the person who is in front of you, through the circumstance that existence brings forward to you. To be happy is the greatest blessing. It unfolds a totally new, unknown and unknowable realm. One Sufi master, Shakuntala Devi, always used to bless anyone bowing to her by saying, "Be always happy." If you really decipher these simple words, these will manifest a totally new realm. When a master says something, the seeker needs to introspect on these words. The master can never be wrong or unconscious. The very fact that he or she is a master implies now something has changed within. A master may look at you, but in reality, he differs in his understanding of the cosmic phenomena and awareness. None of his actions are guided by unconscious. Even when he moves his hand, he is totally aware of this. Let this be your meditation each moment. A new meaning will unfold in life. Serenity, blessedness will engulf you. Only then it can be said that you are living in the image of a master. Then something of the master, his awareness, his understanding will be part of you as blessing. Someone came to Buddha and inquired, "What is your way? Can you explain your way in a few words? Are you a philosopher, thinker?" A barrage of questions. Buddha said, "I am a physician. I cannot tell you anything about what is this, but I can give you a vision so that you can see for yourself what is it." When once I inquired, I used to be inquisitive in asking questions. When I asked my grandmother Shakuntala Devi, "Why do you say always be happy?" She told me, "You ask too many questions. Listen to these words carefully, introspect, and find the meaning, the essence of this yourself. Happiness and sorrow are like two shores of the river of consciousness. Between these two shores flows the consciousness. You can lean to the left or to the right. But in the river, you are like a twig that is flowing with the current. To flow with the current is acceptance. You have merged your will with that of the divine. You do not know why is this happening, why this particular circumstance or situation has come upon you. If you trust, something will reveal to you." You remember the last time of Jesus. He was condemned to death. He was going to be crucified. He had to carry his cross on his shoulders. When he reaches there, he was expecting the miracle to happen, that he was considering himself the only begotten son, that Father will come and save him. Nothing like that happened. He was hanged on the cross along with three other persons. Jesus was in the middle and the other two was on either of the sides. There on the cross, the human mind of Jesus complains, "Father, why have you forsaken me?" Human mind always complains, "Why has this circumstance and situation come upon me? I have been doing everything right. Why has this come upon me?" You are imposing your will onto that of the whole. Jesus remains restless at that moment. The very next moment, something descends and it emerges out of him, "Let thy will prevail." As soon as the word "let thy will prevail" emerged out of Jesus, Jesus was no more son of Mary and Joseph. He was transformed in that very particular acceptance. "Let thy will prevail. I know not what is the secret in this. Why do I have to go through this pain and agony? I know it not. Still, let thy will prevail." And in that, all the pain and suffering vanishes. A joy overwhelms you that I am being the cause for something to happen for humanity. Jesus became Christ. He is no more son of Mary and Joseph. Instead, he is now the only begotten Son of God, Jesus the Christ. This very moment, the moment you accept everything totally, is like a flowering of meditation, a satori as Zen tradition calls it. So this particular phrase, "always choose to be happy under all circumstances and situations," may remind you of these kind of incidents. When Al-Hilaj Mansur declared Analhaq, Analhaq means "I am the light, I am the truth." According to Islamic tradition, saying this is blasphemy. He declared, his master Junaid told him not to declare. He said, "Who am I not to declare? If God wants to be declared, let it, then be it so, then so it be." Someone asked, "What is the ultimate in Sufism?" Al-Hilaj said, come tomorrow and you will see. And Al-Hilaj was brought on the public place and he was to be punished. The Islamic tradition of punishment is totally different. His limbs were severed. As one of his limbs was severed, he began to laugh and he called out to the person who had inquired what is the ultimate in Sufism. He said, where are you? Come and see what is the ultimate in Sufism. His limbs were cut and Al-Hilaj was laughing. Everyone, even those who were punishing him, they were surprised. There was no pain and agony. He has overcome that. Something of a different nature has overwhelmed him. This is the ultimate in Sufism. But these are the two possibilities. I spoke of these two possibilities. The third, the transcendence happens on its own. This is duality, happiness or sorrows, acceptance or non-acceptance, good and bad, alike any other duality. This is dichotomy, duality, happiness or unhappiness. These are the two shores of the river, a river of consciousness. Amidst these, floating, where are you going? No, it's not. Where will it lead to? Where will the flow lead to? Us too, nobody knows, yet still you trust the river, you trust the flow. Do you know what is the reverse of flow? If you arrange these words in the reverse order, do you know what it becomes? It becomes wolf, and as such it is flow. So when you are with the flow, wherever you will go, there is trust in you. Trust in the whole that existence never does anything wrong. If this is happening, there has to be a reason. When you are traveling along the path, there are many stones, obstructions. These obstructions are like pebbles, like stones. You can transform these through your awareness into milestones. There is a difference between a stone by the roadside and the milestone. Everyone looks to the milestone. Let each one of your steps become a milestone, and it will help the seekers along the path of the inward journey. The third is the transcendence along that. There is something more beyond happiness and sorrow. When you are not affected by happiness and sorrow, then you attain to the state of equanimity. You attain to the state of Buddhahood. He is not affected by the pairs of opposites. He is equipoised amidst all these duality. Nothing happens. When happiness comes, when sorrow comes, you are bewildered. You are shattered in the moments of calamities. I remember many years ago, my father wanted me to study physics, chemistry and maths. I had no interest in that. I failed once, twice. Arrangement was made for me to change the discipline and switch over to the other subjects. But my father resisted that if I have to study, it has to be the science subjects, otherwise there is no need. This year I again failed. My uncle, the Sufi Omkarnath, wrote me a letter and in that there was a couplet. Shayad fiza se ho koi nai surat bahar ki. Kuch maslihat isi mein hai mere parwardigar ki. When I introspected on these words, shayad means perhaps. Fiza means autumn. Shayad fiza se ho koi nai surat koi, and surat means form, of bahar means spring. May autumn bring a new portrayal to the spring. Each time when autumn comes, after that the spring has a new meaning. Once the leaves fall from a tree during autumn, it has its own beauty. There is no lament when autumn comes, because When you look in the scheme of existence during autumn, all the leaves of the tree fall. The leaves first turn gold, golden yellow. They fall and create a new hue in the atmosphere. And it is in preparation for the upcoming winter season. During winter, the trees are covered with snow. Had this in the scheme of existence, the autumn not been there, the spring be meaningless. It is the autumn that gives a new meaning to the spring. Each time when autumn comes after that, the spring is more beautiful, full of flowers, blossoming everywhere. But that can happen only when you accept autumn without a krum, without a murmur. Kuch maslihat isi mein hai mere parvardigar. What is the wish of my master in this, I know it now. The total acceptance of everything that happens leads you to transcendence, where neither the happiness nor the sorrow will affect you in any way. You will consider these as two sides of the same coin. Is head more important or tail? You know it well. These are the two sides of the coin. But when it comes to happiness and sorrow, you cannot see these as two sides of the same coin. Instead, you consider these as contradictory to one another. When you see these as part of one synergistic harmony, a different kind of serenity dawns in you, and that is the transcendence beyond the duality of happiness and sorrow. This is the second kalma. And because of the significance of this particular statement, I had included this into the kalmas or the commandments. Initially, there had been 11 commandments. 8 were given by Hazrat Ibn Khalid Ghazwani رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ, and 3 were given by Shah Bahauddin Naqshband رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ. And this 12th, I had used the phrase, the message from Shakuntala Devi, the Naqshbandi master, as the 12th kalma. So the second is choose to be happy, and I place them in an order of the journey of an individual. First, you have to be conscious of your breathing, breathe consciously, then choose to be happy, then comes the other kalmas or commandments. The third is nazar bar kadam. Nazar means sight, kadam means steps. Watch your steps.